Now, did we all party to the party?
Oh, there we have it.
But it was a beautiful evening. Today, we've got a really powerful agenda, and I want to, focus a little bit on the notion that a good idea is not enough. And the difference between a good idea and a successful one is execution. How do you get that good idea off center point and move it along so that it becomes a reality? I think the world is full of people who have good ideas, and just how do you get them into the public venue and make things, good things happen is something that we all like to understand better. It all depends, I think, on your political competence, your interaction with other people, the way you present the idea, what kind of venue. Leadership is about moving that agenda. It's from the germ of an idea to a successful implementation and finally getting results. We all dream of that, to be able to have that happen. And from my perspective, it's kind of nice that once you get elected into office and you have a lot of people working for you, they aim to please. And so you get a good idea, and you got a lot of... Surround yourself with smart people is the first thing I would always recommend. Smart, self-starters, highly energized people, and they help you work through that. But to it's not just a function of your personality, but a result of your political confidence is some might define it. So today we have Professor Samuel B. Bacharach. Sam Bacharach is the co-founder of the Bacharach Leadership Group. He's the McKinley Grant Professor in the Department of Organizational Behavior at Cornell University. He's head of Cornell's New York City-based Institute for Workplace Studies and the co-founder of BLG Training and Consulting. And he's been teaching behavioral skills for leaders around the globe. He writes a weekly blog column for Inc. magazine on pragmatic leadership. And he's authored over 150 articles, or he's edited over, he's author or editor of over 20 books, including Get Them on Your Side and Keep Them on Your Side. His newest books on the political skills of leadership will be out this spring, and it's called The Agenda Mover. So we've got something to look forward to. With this, along with his colleagues, he's worked with companies, major companies across the United States, Cisco, Frontier Communications for Warner Music, Mindtree, the University of Virginia, and the University of Michigan, and lots of corporations use his material in-house to train their leaders, or their potential leaders, to give them better ideas on how to work. So let me stop talking and bring on Dr. Sam.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Governor. First of all, it's an honor to be, I'm an academic, to be introduced by a governor to introduce by a governor is one thing. To introduce by anyone in Louisiana is another. I want to tell you how much, first of all, I want to tell you how you spell purgatory. Purgatory is spelled 9 a.m. Saturday morning. that's how you it's a small group, and so when I grew up, my father was a superintendent in Brooklyn. You didn't have to guess much about that, the way I speak the English language. And we one day decided that I would have a birthday party when I was 8 years old. And we arranged everything. We had an electric train there in the room. And no one showed up, just two kids from down the street. The entire building didn't show up. And my mother said to me, and I really got upset, and my mother said to me, judge the quality of the people that show up, not the numbers. So on that note, let's continue with our good morning. So that note, we'll continue. I want to take also a moment to speak to the issue of, right off the bat, of here we are in an institute that I've had taken great pride in some affiliation. It began a number of years ago, 10 years ago, I met the famous, infamous, and totally delightful committed Laura Bado. And all our thoughts are always with her during this period. And there's no way you can say no to Laura, and you don't want to, not because she, but because her sense of commitment to this cause is very important. But I also want to talk to the whole issue of why the gender issue and skills. Let's just take it off the bat. Here we have, notice Louisiana women. I'm not from Louisiana, and I'm not a woman. And so why? Let me tell you what I fundamentally believe. I fundamentally believe that the skills of leadership, the very skills that you need in leadership, are transferable. The core skills are transferable. They're transferable across gender, across culture, across age, across everything. The skills, the burdens may be different. It may be tougher to execute leadership as a woman because of stereotypes and whatever. The burdens may be, or power, the burdens may be different. I'm not saying that the field is flat out there, but I'm saying some of the basic skills, some of the basic micro-behavioral skills. So when the governor says, you need to execute no matter what, who you are. So my whole notion is, I do not know from any personal sense of what it really, really means to face those burdens, those subtle and sometimes explicit burdens and challenges and stereotypes, whatever. All I can speak to is those core skills that I believe are transferable, that we all need to have. You need them, no matter what. It may be, in fact, a lot easier for me as an aging guy from Manhattan than it is for you in Louisiana. I don't know, but the skills of having to get people, mobilize people, those skills are the same. And I think that's important to understand, because a lot of times we exclude people from learning those particular skills, the skills of execution. We so focus on the burdens, which are important, that we forget the skills. So, I mean, so that I think is the approach I'm taking. So I was told a little while ago, and you'll be glad that we slowed down, and I will be delighted. I was told a while ago, I was supposed to talk, relax when I say this, for 2 hours, like hell, I'm going to talk to you, relax, it's not going to happen. But the point is, but what would I like to do today? I like to, number one, demythologize leadership. I like to, let's get it out there. It's not about your inner child. And it's not about a lot of things. I really am not your therapist. I mean, and I have nothing against therapists. I'm married to a therapist. I've done nothing against her. But the truth is, your struggle is your struggle. All right? I won't make you less shy. And I won't make you transformational rather than transactional, whatever thing you want. The point is, what I believe we can teach people is the issue of how do you move agendas. Now think of the people that come to think of the people that come here. Think of the people you're trying to serve. I remember a few years ago, I gave a talk, it was 10 years ago. Tell me it was two, please. Oh God. Oh. Well, at least I'm getting out in time to still get Social Security, which some of you, well, never mind. Now the point is, I remember a young woman here. And I remember her calling me in New York City. And I remember talking to her about a graduate program in Washington. And I remember telling her that she'd get an online degree. And I remember talking to her back and forth, and I've kept communication a few years ago. The people that need help, or those people, they need help one thing. They don't need help necessarily knowing their goals. They need help achieving those goals. They don't need help for you to give them dreams. They need help in following those dreams. These women need skills. They don't need skills. They're already coming to you bright. They're already coming to you competent. They may not have those worldly nuts and bolts skills that some of us may have picked up along the way. And that's what today's talk is about. It's not about the dreams. It's about the skills of execution. Let's demythologize leadership. I want you to do me a favor for 1 second. I want to put something on the table. If you have a piece of paper, do you have a piece of paper? Give me, just take 2 minutes. Just indulge me. Indulge me. Name me three charismatic leaders. three charismatic leaders. Name me three charismatic leaders.
Do we have to like them?
Huh? Do
we have to like them?
No, absolutely not. Three charismatic leaders, just for the fun of it. People who really historically charismatic leaders. I want to make a very simple point. Three charismatic leaders. The training director told me participation is important, that's why. Three charismatic leaders. The lovely thing about asking a group of adults rather than undergraduate or graduate students, nobody worries if I'm going to grade it. All right. So if I can just, if you have it on a piece of paper, can I just pass me the piece of paper, if you don't mind? I'll read you some names. All right. Two is good, too. I make a point. Any? I'm going to read these very quickly. This is not a trick. There's nothing to win. I just thought of doing this right now, okay? All right. You got anything back there? No paper. All right. Let me read you some names. I'll be remiss if I don't grab the governor's list. Did I go? All right. We got it? All right. Let me name. Who do I read first? Trump or Pope Francis? This is tough. Oprah, Ellen DeGeneres, I didn't ever pronounce her name. I'm going to put this list over here. Trump, North Korea dictator. Is Trump the North Korean dictator? Bill Clinton, Barack Obama, Edward Edwards, Russ Herman, Kathleen Blanco. Congratulations. Bill Clinton, Obama, Gandhi, Clinton, Margaret Thatcher, Gandhi, Martin Luther King, Bill Clinton, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, Barack Obama, Obama, Pope, the Pope, the first Bush. Barack Obama, Billy Graham, okay, I'm going this quickly, John Kennedy, Laura Badu, Trump again as a Korean dictator, I must be repeating myself, Bill Clinton, Gandhi, Martin Luther, et cetera, et cetera. All right, what's interesting about this list? One person got the trick. It is extremely, you can ask this any place you want. One person went out of the way, and where are you? They gave me three women. The list always comes down to, was that you?
No, I have one though, that's not right. There.
Who's the person that gave me the three women? You did.
I can give it to three women, but I do have Oprah.
On Oprah, yeah, right, okay. But Oprah, now here's the point. For the most part, if you ask people about charisma, you get men. You get men. And in this culture, we tend to think that leaders have to be charismatic. Look for a moment at how we run campaigns. Look for a moment. The last thing we debate in this country is competence. We debate charisma all the time. He is such and such, believes such and such, and that tends to be a disproportionate. Now, why is that? The point is that leadership is culturally bound. That leadership is culturally bound. And my point is, you can't rely, most of us can't rely on charisma. You can't rely on charisma. You can't. If you go beneath the last 8 years ago, you can't really rely on charisma. And when people tell you, you've got to change your personality, you've got to reach out, well, you know why? Maybe you shouldn't have to. Maybe you should be judged whether you can move an idea and are competent enough to get something accomplished. Maybe it is. Maybe I really don't want, since it's Saturday morning, and maybe I really don't want someone in the White House to keep me entertained. Maybe I want someone to get something done up there, okay? So maybe you want competence. And if you think about it, think about corporate leaders. You really, really believe that Bill Gates, have you ever heard him talk? He is not charismatic.
Yeah.
Bezos will put you to sleep. And we're talking about charisma. You can't rely. Oh, sure, there's the upside of charisma. They'll inspire people, etc. Of course, I always like to point out there's also the downsides of charisma. These guys, you know, saints and devils can be charismatic. You know, you may not like it, but some of these guys were charismatic. Everybody forgets charisma got people to commit suicide in Jonestown. Charisma brought you to the Nazi party too. So not completely, but the whole point is you got to look at the upside. But what we're talking about charisma. Leadership isn't just about personality. I hope I don't have to tell you what I have to tell my smart Cornell undergraduates who want to know who that is. That's Winston Churchill. And then they again ask me who that is, but never mind. We'll keep. All right. Leadership isn't about vision. Let's talk about Dr. King for a moment. A few years ago, this is many years ago, but actually, I've got this thing with New Orleans. I realized it happened in New Orleans. I was talking to the Minority Caucus of the Electrical Workers Union. I teach in part of what I do is the labor school. And I asked someone to name me a great leader. It said Martin Luther King. And I agreed. And then I turned around and I said to him, why? And he said to me, I'll never forget this, he said to me because, and he must have been in his mid-80s then, as a labor leader, he said to me because he had a great new vision. And in the most deafening few minutes of my life, I said to him, no, he didn't. And I said he didn't have a new vision. And I stood there, and there was dead silence in the room. And I said, he had the same vision your great-grandparents had, your grandparents had, and you have today. The difference is he knew how to execute on that vision. You see, the difference between this guy and me, if Martin Luther King, God willing, was alive and had a Chrysler dealership in Kansas City, I would invest. The point is, he could run a corporation. You know, everybody keeps talking about charisma. The man counted, get about 20-some-odd hours of charismatic speeches. The rest of his life, he was worrying about SNCC. He was worried about this. He was worrying about Carmichael. He was worrying what to do. He was moving agendas. He was in the business of cutting a deal with Lyndon Johnson. Okay, trying to move an agenda. He wasn't sitting home going charisma all the time. So it is about the skills of execution. It is not about your personality transfer. You know, you want to deal with personalities, deal with therapists. I mean, it's fine. Leadership isn't about good ideas either. It isn't about good ideas. This is what we're sold. You go to Barnes & Noble, they'll tell you about this. It isn't about good ideas. Good ideas and visions aren't always enough. Vision without execution, folks, is hallucination. I swear to you, I'm about to tell you the truth, and I'm not making it. Oh, this is good, a small group. Well, I get worried, the lawyer's in the back. The point is, the vision, think about it for a moment. A number of years ago, many, many years ago, I was sitting in my Cornell office in Ithaca years ago on something called BitNet. Anybody remember what BitNet was? It was the first phase of the internet. And I had this idea. I said, this is a hell of a way of selling books. I can sell books like this. I sat down and I wrote with a friend of mine a four-page plan. And to this day, no one uses Bacharach.com and use Amazon.com. I had the vision. I really did. I had a total vision. You know, I would really be, it didn't work out, folks. But the point is, that's what it comes down to. We take a look at the political scene. No one needs any vision. Let's talk about corporate America. People go, creativity. Give me 8 students, give me 8 of you. We'll come up with an idea that's creative enough. We'll start a business. I write for Inc. magazine a lot, and I keep on going to the Inc. 5000, Inc. 500. There are more ideas there, as the governor said, that you know what to do. We don't have a creativity problem. We have an execution problem. The ideas are a dime a dozen. Now, for a moment, and I'll come back to this, let's think about leadership traits. But before I go, I'm going to come back to this in a second. Leadership, like this with a small L, Bobby Knight once said, I love this quote, Bobby Knight, the infamous coach at the University of Indiana, or as they call him, Mr. Charm, once said, calling to his class of, and is he still alive? Yes. Is he really? Yes. Really? What does he do? About for who? Terra Magazine? Why? Bobby Knight, who had the Senate Mass. Bobby Knight, who held the chairs of sadomasochism at the University of Indiana. Bobby Knight, the first thing you need to know about people, about leadership, is that most of you simply do not have it. Let's get real. If leadership was used by these criteria, most of us wouldn't be allowed in the room. It would be simply an exclusive club. That's one of the issues with gender. It isn't whether you can lead, it's whether culturally people will accept people as leading. It's not about whether you can lead. Take a look at how many women we have now, CEOs, lack of. It's whether they accept you as a leader. It's not about that. And that was the Bobby Knight line. I believe in mundane leadership. This is simply one of the most boring people I've ever known and seen. Dwight Eisenhower, not that he's my hero, just makes a point. And for those of us who sort of grew up on the cusp of me and Dwight, Dwight Eisenhower was not exactly charismatic, all right? Dwight Eisenhower had a capacity, however. Halberstam once referred about Eisenhower as the mundane leading the mundane. Well, Dwight Eisenhower, the bland leading the bland, I'm sorry. What Eisenhower knew was how to lead a campaign. If you study for a moment, from a leadership point of view, not from a drama point of view, and not from, and I do this from corporate execs, but you know what we look at? What was on the more main, the invasion on D-Day? As a task, as a job. What did it take to actually get that thing off the ground? You had egomaniacs here, you had this over there. What did it really take for us? What it took, and Governor, please, don't be traumatized by the next slide. It took a campaign. it took a campaign. What?
Needs a merciful ending.
Needs a merciful ending. It took a campaign. My point is that everyone in this room has a campaign that they want to execute, an agenda they want to follow, and that's absolutely, absolutely critical. It took a campaign. It is about micro skills to move ideas to agendas to results. It's about the little things you have to do. I believe in leadership as a checklist. What do you do? What don't you do? What mistakes you make? What don't you do? I really believe that. I believe that you lead not because of you, but sometimes in spite of you. Okay? I mean, and that, yes, you do. Because, you know, my whole notion of the world is, I know exactly. I know, for example, you have to know where to lead, how to lead. For example, one thing I've known about myself is I've been at Cornell for many, many, many years. I also know that I know how to execute certain things. I've done institutes, I've done that. But I also know that in certain level, I'm not a person that's going to be a president of a university. I know my niche. That's not my little world, okay? My little world is a different world. It's a world of a campaign. Most of us don't need to lead all of the front stage stuff in the world. Most of us know how to lead without, don't necessarily, someone needs to be on the front stage, but it doesn't mean we all need to be on the front stage. It all needs to be on the front stage. You know, a friend of mine who just stepped down as our provost is a very good friend, and we can all lead together. He may deserve, he's better on the front stage for that purpose than I am. He's low key, he doesn't say anything, he's quiet. And inevitably people think he has something brilliant to say. Me, I'm loud, overbearing, pushy, but not so people think, oh my God. So the point is, you have to find your niche. But no matter your personality, it comes down to moving agendas and, if you will, getting results. Now, I want to ask you a question. Do you have an agenda? Have you had an agenda item that didn't get results? Let me give you one. Give me an example, if you will, of something that you can think of, even culturally, in the society, that just didn't move. It could be from the news, anything, that just didn't move. What can you think about? Think for a moment. Okay, something that just didn't move. What didn't move, or for you?
Getting rid of nutria by eating them.
Really?
It didn't work.
What else? What's an agenda item you have that you want to move? I'll give you one. Let's take this center, all right? It's been going, it's been starting, it's been going. How do you make this into a more robust sturdy center in the context of the fact that there's cutbacks in the states on higher education? And how do you move an agenda to stabilize what is being done for women in education? What do you do? What do you do? What are you going to do? You need to find some sort of campaign. I'll give you an example. You need to establish a campaign, a micro campaign that really, really gets something done. Now, campaigns are weird. And the governor sort of stole my thunder. But that's okay. That's why she can be called governor. I'm simply a professor. But what she said, is really true. It's one thing to get elected. It's another thing to execute a campaign after you've been elected. It's another thing. So, you know, I would just say this. You got to say this. You know, I now admit that it's, I know I don't. I have, and I confess this, it's Saturday morning, so I'll say it quietly. I have, just as a footnote, Democratic tendencies, so forgive me, okay? But that said, there is the man that ran for president and ran a brilliant campaign, and then I have my hesitation, where's my unified single provider healthcare system, okay? I mean, then I have the question of, was the same talent used all the way on the execution type of stuff? That's an example. Let me give you another Democrat that comes to mind. Could hardly win a popularity contest, absolutely could not get elected, could not execute on many fronts. But there's a wonderful three-book trilogy by Anthony Carroll, which I recommend everybody read, on Lyndon Johnson. Read once in a while Lyndon Johnson, not from the point of view of his politics, I mean, a transformational character, and take a look at a book called Master of the Senate. Master of the Senate. And realize to what degree Johnson was able to manage the Senate. Take a look at Johnson's role in his relation to Martin Luther King in terms of moving the Civil Rights Bill. And what degree? These are people that can actually execute agendas. Execute agenda. Now, let's give me a third one. Now, people, if this was Ithaca, New York, for the next line, I'd be thrown out of the room. But since it's not Ithaca, so let's talk about Richard Nixon for a moment. Forget everything. Forget everything else. But price and wage controls, all these little things. You know, everybody forgets that given today, by today's standards, Richard Nixon would be a socialist. I mean, take a look at healthcare, unified healthcare. The guy moved everything through the system. So what I'm talking about is moving agendas. Take a look at Bill Gates, the same type of thing. So it's the micro skills. And what do they mean? And I'll go find it. Look, in a world in which you live on a tightrope, that is, everything is pressed. You're stuck in a snow globe. You're making decisions, but you never have full information. You're leading, but you never have information to lead. You're constantly playing your gut hunches. You're muddling through. You know, the idea that you're going to plan, I love this. Oh, we're going to plan to do something. Let me tell you, last time anyone planned to do anything was in the Soviet Union in the five-year plan in 1958. Everybody else is giving you plan. The problem is no one actually executes the plan. Because you're muddling through. And muddling through is not a bad thing. It means that you're making an adjustment as you're going down the road. So leaders have to be people that can play their hunches, can muddle through, and can make decisions when they don't have all the information available. And I'll tell you, that's what we're looking for. Now, I hate to really point out, but I cannot imagine, and God knows I don't want to leave, but I cannot imagine in your experience how many times you had not all the information, you didn't have a plan that doesn't work, and basically you're muddling through because you had to go on, not muddle through in the next step, but doing incrementally, saying what's the next step. It's a water, for those of you who do computer programming, it's a waterfall approach. In the iterative process, I'll take the next step and see what happens. What happens. And then, of course, you have this whole, but, oh well. Okay, good night. That was easy. What do? Oh, I see. I'll see that as a, hold on, I'm sorry. Technology is never, you've got to take action. Because whatever you do, you have to take action. And not only that, you have to take action and you know that whatever you're going to do, someone is coming after you. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. So you know you can't do it alone. The point is, think of this world you're living in. It's a tightrope. I've got minimum information. I've got to play my hunches. I've got a gun to my head to make a decision. I'm muddling through. And in this context, someone says, okay, lead. I lead. And you know everyone's going to blame you. You see, the only people that think you can make optimal decisions are game theorists, economists who sit in places like Harvard and never come out to the real world, or at LSU. They think they can make the optimal decision. But it's important to let academics think they can make optimal decisions. The rest of us, although I am an academic as a footnote, I don't deny my heritage, the rest of us are faking it a lot of the time. But not faking it in a bad way. Making decisions because there isn't enough time. In business, why do you think Microsoft puts all those products out sometimes that didn't work, or Apple, and then they call them back? Because better to get it out there than wait till the competition comes along. So that becomes, it's a strategy. It's a leadership decision. So it's not perfect. It's not perfect. Perfection is the demise of leadership. If you're waiting for perfection, I got this really great play you should see by Beckett called Waiting for Godot. He ain't coming, all right? The point is, that's the notion here. Now, here's my point. In this context, how do you lead? From ideas to agendas to results. I want to suggest to you, enough of this, I want to suggest to you concrete things you must keep in mind. Concrete things you must keep in mind. And what we're working on. And let me give you the history of this. When I tell you, I'm suggesting this is a long road for me, and to a large degree, and this is unbeknownst to many of you, but one of the road really begins on a certain level when I say that I owe much to this group and to the center. It's true, because one of the first speeches I ever gave on this stuff, I spent many of my years being an academic, was here about 10 years ago, and it got me really thinking about these issues. Since then, here's the issue. This model, this one we developed, working with like a lot of corporations, it's been a really iterative process. So for example, and I want to just show you, one organization came along and said to us, no one can move agendas in our organization. It's a company called SunGuard, and we went in there and we said, oh, what you need is political competence. Got to get people smart politically. And then he says, but they keep on dropping the ball. And he says, well, you need managerial competence. I'll tell you what. Another organization said, oh, people don't come up with ideas. A group of organizations in India, you need ideation. Another corporation said, well, you don't work with the customer in your context. And we repeated it. And we'll show you what I'm talking about in a minute. There are four things leaders really have to worry about, especially leaders in organizations. And let me talk about leaders in organizations. 90% of the women that are going to go through your programs are not going to simply be entrepreneurs. But it's the same thing. Some will be entrepreneurs, but a lot of them are going to look for corporate, public sector jobs. And in that context, they'll have to work in an organizational context. They're not just going to out there. Sure, they'll be entrepreneurs. And they face similar challenges. But this is what they're facing. They've got to go the distance on the basis of contextual, ideation, political, and managerial competence. Let me talk about each one. And let me talk about what I'm talking about for each one. First, contextual competence. Do you as a leader really understand what's going on around you? Do you read the environment well? Ideation competence. Once you've read it, can you bring it inside your organizations and articulate it from the rest of us that you want to have execute on your ideas and your direction? You have the sense of the terrain, but can you bring it in, and can we then mobilize the ideas that we need to? Second, you get these ideas, wonderful. Do you have the political savvy to push the ideas through the organization? Because do you have the political savvy to get it through the iron needle? Because not everyone's going to get behind your ideas. It's a zero-sum game. And finally, when things really get rough and people are fed up with you and your team, can you manage to go the distance and not drop the ball? Everything else is nonsense for me. These are the four things you need to do. You have to understand the environment. You've got to bring the ideas into the organization and mobilize good people around those ideas. You have to sustain the political momentum, and you have to get mobilize political momentum and then sustain the stuff through. And if I was putting a group of young women through an organization, through leadership training, I would be worrying about these issues. This is what I'd be worrying about. This is what execution's about. Think of it in the public sector or in the private sector. I'll give you start with private sector. There's a company that we were just at in India, in Bangalore. I go to Bangalore lately a lot, and anybody get a chance to go to Bangalore, Oh, we're being taped, okay. let me simply say, Hoboken, New Jersey is a wonderful place. The point is, you go out to Bangalore and you realize what a divided world we live in. For those of you who have ever been there, you can be in the gates of a corporate international organization and to see poverty right beyond the wall. It's actually so tragic, you have to really hold it up. But there's a couple of organizations I work there, and one is a lot of the Indian IT industry is now transferring. It's changing, and it used to be outsourcing, and now they want to become a different type of business. They want to become solution-based companies, as we hear a lot in companies in the world. Now, how do they know that? Because they've gotten a sense of their environment, okay? But here's what happens. So somebody says, we should move in a different direction. And they get an internal team, and suddenly all the old guard says, look, we're better off just doing the old outsourcing stuff we did all the time. Forget it, we're making money. Somebody says, no, we got to get politically smart. And then their teams get burnt down saying, look, they're paying us for one thing. Why don't we just stay with the old stuff? It's a battle. It's a battle. Leadership is about, it's a battle. Whether you're talking about healthcare or we're talking about, it's a battle. So here are the steps of this battle. Leadership is a campaign to go the distance. Let me just begin very quickly with ideational competence. Look, first, you have to frame the challenge. How are we doing? I'll stop in a few minutes to take a break, but how are we doing on time? Do you know what time it is?
Fine.
Yeah. All right. Listen, I have this rule. Anybody bored, tired, I have absolutely no ego involvement in it. I say that, I actually don't mean it. But let's just to talk about it. You have a challenge. Give me a challenge. Think of a political challenge. Let's talk about peace in the Middle East. Let's talk about peace in the Middle East.
A small challenge.
Peace in the Middle East. And I'm not being glib about this. I'm not being glib about this at all. I'm not glib. How do you define it as a leader? How do you define what you mean by peace in the Middle East? Let's talk about excellence in education. Okay? How do we define excellence in education? What does it really mean for excellence of education? What are you going to do? You as a leader have to have the capacity to frame the challenge. You know, you can talk till you're blue in the face, but you have to have the capacity to frame the challenge. And what in the corporate world, do you know what, and I am not one, I've seen the movie and I really am against the deification of Steve Jobs. But be it the case, the one thing I really believe is he understood the challenge and he articulated well. Would I want to work for this guy? Different issue. But he understood the challenge and he articulated well. And he really did. And that absolutely, Bill Gates understood the challenge. In the early days, when Chambers was heading Cisco, he understood, in the early days, he understood the challenge and the opportunity and did something about it. When you don't understand it, you can't articulate. So great leaders, in fact, frame the challenge well. And how do they do it? And I'm doing the first two sections very quickly because I've got less interest at the moment. They actually do research. They take a look at what's going on. Now, I know all this stuff, you search what people need and the polls, etc. Let me be the devil's advocate, not the devil's advocate. Let me play the flip side of all this polling stuff, okay? I love this. People go, well, you're checking with the polls and you're constantly changing. You know, there is something to be said to be changing with the wind and seeing. There's one, you have to change and you don't want to flip-flop. No, the expression. We don't have flip-flopping, by the way, has dropped from the English language. It was there 4 years ago, it was all over the place. The point is, you want to monitor without having the sense that you have no direction. You want to monitor without having that you don't want to sort of flip-flopping on it. You want to partner with stakeholders, the S is at the bottom. You want to partner with the stakeholders. You want to know who the people out there are. If you're in a business, now last night, it was my delight, and I'm going to embarrass her, to sit next to a woman who is in back writing on the garbage can, which I also don't take it as offense, but she's doing governmental affairs for Chevron, correct? Now, I would bet you that if she isn't doing this, then bowling is my favorite sport, okay? The point is, that means monitoring all the time what's going on, right?
Right.
And that means she has to partner with, it doesn't mean sitting in her office waiting for someone to call you. So one of the things we forget, now take a, and then you've got to be aware of your own capacity. What can we do? What can't we do? What can we deliver? What can't we deliver? Now that's true on a corporate level. But when you speak to these young women, it's also true in their lives. It's also true in how they deal with the world. Are they monitoring, doing research in the context of their world? Do they understand who to partner with? Do they understand their capacity? Do they understand what can be actually done? What can they, do they understand their environment? And let me give you an example from higher education. Every so often, I give a talk to community colleges in New York. And I go in there, and I give a talk. And you know what the talk is about? How you can get to an Ivy League school from a community college. And what it's about isn't about how you should get another SAT, but it's about is you're not aware of the environment enough. You're not aware that disproportionate amount of Ivy League schools allow for transfer students. And you're not aware what you need to do. You have to be aware. Here's the things you need to be. Now, that may not seem corporate, but that notion of being aware of the challenge, now that you frame the challenge, you've got to do something about it. You take the challenge and you bring it in. So step one to leadership execution, frame, do your homework by looking at the environment. If you're going to move this center, find out who are the supporters. Find out who's out there in the environment. Find out what the alternatives are. People don't do, and I hate saying this as an academic, people don't do serious research. They really wing it. And that's dangerous. And that's really dangerous. So if you're doing governmental affairs for Chevron, and you're not doing your homework about what's going on, what's mobile doing, what's BNP, what's going on, and especially here in this environment in the last 10 years, you've got to be aware of all these partners and all these notions and images, etc. You've got to do it. From the micro to the macro, from the individual to the organization, frame the challenge. That's contextual competence, and I'm doing short. Then you've got the whole notion of ideation competence. Once you frame the challenge, can you transfer the challenge to something real? Can you actually do something about the challenge? Transfer it to something real. And that means to me a couple little things very quickly. Collaborate with stakeholders for solution ideas. Can you in the organization? Can you in the organization, now go in the organization, find out who do you need there? How do I come up with solutions? How do I do something about it? Do I need to get you on my side? How do I actually do something? How do I collaborate for divergence and convergence? What does that mean? Let's go back, and I'm only picking, and I don't know because she was sat next to me, but unless she knows that tomorrow morning something awful is going to happen, and he's got some ideas to share, and she needs to go inside. She doesn't, you know, she really looks smart, right? Have everybody met her? I forget. Felicia, right?
Right.
Felicia really looks smart, right? But let me tell you something about her. She really doesn't know everything. Neither her or anybody else. So not only she needs to do is get a group of people in the room to tell her ideas she didn't think about. Kelly, in a group called IDOs in Stanford, it's a design group, talk about divergent thinking. How do you get a group of people in the room and put every stupid idea on the board and get them to share the ideas? That's a role for a leader. Okay, get them in a room, and then how do you get them to put the ideas together and converge and put those ideas together? So the next step, and it's a long process. I remember a few weeks ago, we had this group of 80 people at the University of Virginia, and we needed to figure out how to restructure the university. So we put 80 people in the room. Sounds crazy, right? We broke them up into like groups, said, okay, for 2 hours, let's get every stupid idea you've ever had on the board. And some of them were crazy. And within the crazy, there was some brilliant, and then what you need to do, how do you connect the ideas to come up with something? I won't go into this detail, but the whole notion of ideating. Now think about it for a moment. This is a long way from charisma. Suddenly you got to go out there, and think about also, again, go to the women that you're trying to impress. I say that when they need to think of the problem. Okay, now go home, get all your friends together, do the worst thing you could possibly do. I know it's hard, but even get your parents in the room and put up every idea you can on a wall to how you're going to pursue your career. That world and the world of the corporation is not a different world. Both are the world of leadership. So, lead for convergence and lead for converge. Come up with diverse ideas and then converge on the ideas. All right? You must gain. All right. And now to my favorite. And this is great. This is really purgatory. Political competence with a governor in the room. This is really going to be good. This is really going to be good. All right. So, let us talk about. I've never run for office. The only time, but my kid is kicking it all out. He's the head of the Cornell Student Council. He's doing well, so he's been well trained. Okay. But here's the point: political competence. Let's talk about politics. Can we stop with another lie? It is not a dirty word. I know dirty words. That's not one of them, okay? It's a skill. Political is a skill. You know, you may have dirty intentions and evil intentions, but politics is a methodology. And I'm really getting tired of people, oh, I don't do politics. Another friend of mine recently was elected dean of a business school, and she said to me, that she didn't do politics. Academia without politics? Come on. Speaking of drinking Gaga Land, I mean, oh my God. You can't lead without being political. That is the simple reality. Saints and sinners are political. That's the reality. You know, and that really is the case. You need to convince people to join you in your effort. Now, I don't want to get biblical here, but I can think of one person. Come on, hang out with me and I'll make you. Never mind, you fill in the blanks, but that's also the idea of mobilizing people. The cause may be different. The actions are the same. We may not have divine inspiration on our side, but we may have a good cause on our side, and we need to be political. So in terms of you that don't engage in politics, and I hope you're enjoying your life as an unmarried hermit someplace, because the rest of us are engaged in heavy political institution, one of them called marriage. That doesn't make it negative. I mean, it doesn't make it negative, but it is. We do certain things because we believe in the agendas or we're moving. Now, I want to talk about this specifically for a few minutes. Political competence. This is a plug. Don't buy this book if you want to sell, but the idea of getting them on their side. I don't go back to this. Really don't. I'll send you the last. But you've got to get people to your side. Day in, day out. When I teach my students, I have no, you know, it's one thing to go in and say, I'm the blah, blah, blah professor. That's good for one lecture. Afterwards, teaching is about getting the students on your side, convincing them that your ideas are worthy of their time and of their effort. Running organizations is about getting people on your side, convincing people that it's worth their time and effort. So great leaders are political. They are political. They try to mobilize coalitions. And people will resist this. They're not going to join you for the sake of joining you. They're going to resist you. Despite your charm, despite your brilliance, no one really gives a hoot as much as you think they do. Okay? You need to convince them. You've got to go in there. Because resistance is easy. Look, I've been at Cornell for a long time, and we're hiring new faculty and going through transition, and I'm going through the transition with them. Two young professors came to see me a few weeks ago into New York and discussed some ideas they want to do, and they were kind of, what did they really think? I was just going to say yes. I've got a few years to go, and I'm most likely hanging it up and do what I want to do. I've got an entrenched interest in not agreeing right away. It doesn't make me evil. But my cohort has a different interest. They're going to have to get me mobilized. Why? Point is, we've got every reason in the world to resist change. Economic reasons, personal reasons. Economic, fear of failure, threats to self. Why in an organization would you want to change anything? Most people don't want to change a thing. Now, when people say this, they think it's a cliche. It is not a cliche. It's not a cliche. If I came to your organization and I said, look, in the short term, we're going to change the compensation system. You'll benefit in the long term, but in the short term, we're going to do this. Or if I say we're going to let a number of people go, but in the short term, we're going to rehire them, but we have to let them go for 5 months because on the books, we have to look as if we're leaner than we are right now. Or if I'm going to say I'm eliminating such a thing, how am I going to do this? How are you going to do this? Or, for example, if we begin to charge many changes, there's always resistance to it. And I can give you examples, but you know it. If you don't know it, think of the way you drive to work. I live on 17th Street in Manhattan. I get in the cab every day. It's stupid, I know, because you should really walk to 34th Street, but that's a different issue. And I always have the same line. It says, where to? I think 34 Madison. If you take 23 across, I'd really appreciate it. I'm telling you, I say this five times a week, and I've been saying it for years. If you take 23 across, we are routinized beings. We are routinized beings. We really, really, really are. We're hardwired. If you take a look at the work that's being done in neurology right now, any physicians here? Oh, good, I can fake it. The point is that there's a wonderful work by people, a guy named David Siegel. We really are hardwired from not accepting change. Take a look at our behaviors even at home. We do stupid things over and over and over and over again. We argue over dumb things we shouldn't argue, but we repeat it all the time. So there is a hardwired component to it. Now, we have plenty of reasons not to act. We have plenty of reasons not to act. Now, I've got a little, how am I doing on time? Maybe you should take 4 minutes. Yeah, what do you think? Why don't we take 4 or 5 minutes? I'll come back for 25 minutes and I'll finish it up. But here's my point. The next section that we want to talk about. What I want you to take away from this, and you will in the next section, is how now, when you've got ideas, you've got the environment, but there's plenty of ways of mobilizing those ideas. I want to come back in about 5 minutes, in about 20 minutes or so, lay out, 25 minutes or so, lay out for you the skills of political competence and not dropping the ball. Now, beneath my humor, or my tend to be light on a Saturday morning, really, people were out to 1 o'clock? God. By the way, I must tell you, I love the way you live in rural Louisiana last night. It was a beautiful house. But I'll tell you, but that said, I really strongly believe that what I'm saying is a value. It's a value of corporations. Corporations are going around now training people in leadership. And what are they doing? We do high potential programs, but what they do, they try to get you to explore more. No. It's really about these micro skills. And when I say these things, do you think I'm stupid enough to think you should do a checklist? Yeah, I'm that dumb. I really believe that there are things you need to do to move an agenda in organizational context. And it needs to become second nature. Second nature. And we teach people about leadership, we need to go through a check process first. I'm reminded of the couple that goes to a couple's therapist. And the couple's therapist tells them, of course, no one in the room here has ever been to a couple's therapist, and bowling is my favorite sport. The point is, a couple's therapist says to them, all right, on Monday you take the garbage out, and on Tuesday she takes the garbage out, you cook, and you get a list, you get a pineapple magnet, and then you get a cherry magnet, and you put the list on the refrigerator. And you live harmony and wonderful for months and months. You're checking the calendar, the magnets, what you're doing right or wrong. I believe that's how you prove, that's how you change leadership. How you change the culture of leadership is to make sure that if after 10 months you're still checking the magnets, it didn't go completely right. Meaning after 10 months, it becomes part of who you are, but it must become a checklist. It must first begin with a pineapple and a cherry magnet, and that's what I'm trying to do. I'm just trying to give you the checklist. So if we take 5 minutes, those of you that are going to run away, I appreciate you being here. For the rest of you, come back for 5 minutes. I promise I'll finish in a half hour, and I'll get it done. Thank you very much. Back for one moment and talk about, before I get into the politics more deeply, about organizational structures, what most of our organizations look like and what they look like. I want to do a comparison for you between two organizations that you may not even think about come together. Let's, for example, talk about, on the one hand, higher education, which just came up. And on the other hand, let's talk about some of the corporate world, right? Especially large corporations. You see, most organizations have become very loose couple systems. They're very loose. Higher education, the problem with higher education, in higher education setting, we have turf, we've got different structures, we have, for example, only in higher education, we have IT systems that duplicate, we have all these problems. But you know what? We have those same problems in Cisco and in Intel and everything else. So these have become monolithic organizations that repeat, duplicate, and when you want to move anything in these organizations, you do it not because someone told you, you do it because you're moving a project. You do it because you have an agenda and you're multitasking globally and you're doing a project. So when as my research capacity, I head to a couple of research institutes at Cornell, we try to mobilize money from NIH, we do it as a project. We got to get the right people in our corner. When we want to try to negotiate indirect costs, we do it as a project. My point is, the corporate world, the public sector world, all have these organizations that are mazes that you need to move something through. And one of the things that I think is important to teach people, especially people that have not encountered these large monolithic worlds that some of these young women may not have, is what this new reality is about. No one is going to be working in a bureaucracy in 10 years from now. It's going to look like a bureaucracy, but it's not going to be the Department of Motor Vehicle Bureau like 25 years ago. It's a new world. And that's important. And in that world, these political skills become important. So let's, for a moment, ask ourselves what's important. And I talked to some of you about years ago and decided to do it again. But very quickly, one of the things you need to do is anticipate what people are going to say. If I come up to you in your organization, I think we need to change some stuff in the organization. You know what she's going to say? Of course we do. You know what she's thinking? Yes, but. No one, it is so politically incorrect to say you're against change and no one says it anymore. Okay, so everybody is for it. But everyone has this sort of mamsy-pamsy qualification. I'm not talking about the got you game. When you go, oh, you did this. No, no. I'm talking about everyone's for you, but there's a subtlety of language. Now, one of the things that I remember saying here, and I've resurrected this, is that people think there are thousands of ways, right? Don't you think there are a lot? If I'm going to say something, how many objections can you put up to my tie?
Several.
Yeah, more than a lot, right?
One is
loud.
One is enough.
Overbearing. How many objections can you? Where do you work?
Dated would be the first one.
What?
Dated.
Dated.
Yeah, that would be the first one to come up.
I don't know. Dated?
Yeah,
all right. All right. The point is, where do you work, sir? No. This is a good. I knew what I meant to do originally. You work in an organization?
Yes. Oh, they're huge.
Oh God.
A huge.
Successful.
So now, what business are you in?
Construction.
All right. So now we've got a development project that we want to do. Okay. Here's what you got. We got 15, 20 buildings. We want you to take them over. They're mostly vacant. You can return them over, the rents are low, the whole business, you can go in and redo whatever you want, et cetera, et cetera. I've got this plan. How many objections do you think you can have against my argument? I'm just throwing something out. A lot?
Quite a few.
My whole point is, I now have to go and convince the two of you. And I'm sure it is the two of you. And I have to convince the two of you to do this, right? Now, my point is, I only have to come up with 7 arguments. You see, cognitively, we're not that complex on this issue. There are only about seven things you can, in a basic way, argue against. Now, I'll show you what I'm talking about, because it is sort of a trick. My point is, if I'm going to anticipate what you're going to say, I'm going to say, how are you going to say yes, but? You're not going to just throw me out. You go, yes, because you're polite, and you're polite. And you're, so you go, yes, but. What's the yes, but game? One, yes, but we've tried it before. Now, I want to tell you the construction in higher education and all these organizations have this thing in common. Yes, but we've tried it before. Okay, second. Oh, you know what? Try healthcare for this for a moment. Yes, but we've tried it before. Whatever your position. Yes, your idea is too risky. All right? Your idea is too risky. I'm going to come to you. Your idea is too risky. You're doing it all wrong. I like the idea, but this is not the way to go about it. What he's trying to do is kill my idea slowly with a soft song here, but he's killing it softly. That's what that song was about. It was about resistance. It wasn't about love. It was about resistance. So that's what he's trying to do. He's trying to kill me. You're doing it wrong. You're doing it wrong. Look at that empathy. I'm doing it right, but you're doing it wrong, all right? You don't know the issues well enough. In my world, you're an academic. What do you know about the real world? Okay. The point is, you don't know the issues well enough. Next, you have ulterior motives. You've got something behind you, whatever it is. Okay. And finally, your ideas are going to make things worse. It's not going to make it more complex. Take a look at all the objections that we have when we debate. No matter your political party, when we debate something, you're always accusing somebody else of maybe it's a good idea, but it's going to make things a lot worse. Now, I want you for a moment. This week, I have a group of undergraduates. I do this for a semester. They follow executives and organizations, but at the same time, they follow crises. The follow crisis. So, unfortunately for all of us, I make them follow crisis. This week, they're following the crisis that we're now all facing, with ISIS, etc., and see what the political debate is about. They follow healthcare, etc., and they are constantly following on what the arguments are people are going to make, you know. So they're following the immigration debate. They're going to follow it for 2 weeks and try to classify the arguments. I would argue that these are the same arguments I have to anticipate before I'm going to go see the two of you. And when people say, you're not, and finally, your proposal won't change a thing. It's not going to change a thing. So now, here's my point. When you go someplace and you're making an argument, it doesn't matter what it's for. It can be for a new construction project. It could be the immigration bill. There are only a few things that people can object to. It's not that complex. So if I have to go in and say, Stephanie, if I'm going to argue Stephanie, I don't know much about her business, but I got to figure out what Stephanie is going to say to me. Now, I don't know in detail what she's going to say to me. And because Ryan doesn't even know in detail what you're going to say to me. The point is, I have to get to do my homework. In doing my homework, I've got to anticipate these arguments. Stephanie's going to say to me, we've tried it before. I've got to be able to repel that. Stephanie's going to say to me, my idea is too risky. Think whatever it is, immigration, healthcare, construction, whatever. Your kid's wanting to go to a different college. These are seven arguments. You're doing it all wrong. You don't know the issues well enough. You have ulterior motives. Your idea will make things worse. Your proposal won't change a thing. The point is, you know what that is? The world. It's also Congress. This is what these people are saying to each other all the time. And you're debating. Now, doing your homework is understanding how to come back and say the following when you say to me each one. So when I say do anticipate what they're coming from, I want you to sit down, look at those seven questions and say, I'm going to push an agenda and here's the things I'm going to challenge on. That's what doing your homework, anticipating what other people are going to say. And once you've done that, inevitably, and I'm going to talk about this quickly, you've got to create a coalition. You've got to create a coalition. That means you and I are going to gang up on him, okay? But the point is, you have to create a coalition. Now, I want to talk about two words, team and coalition. I'm a big coalition fan. You know, I mean, for example, I live not far from Madison Square Garden. The New York Knicks are what we call a team. They don't play like a coalition. The point is, nothing happens there. When you have a sense of common purpose, so people really buy into a common purpose, it's a bit more than simply being a team for me. You're coalescing. Now, in our culture, when we hear coalition, we go, well, I don't know. But that's what you want. If you want this center to succeed, you don't need everyone in your corner. You need some coalitions in your corner, some key people in your corner that are really, really pushing. And if you want to push something through Congress, you don't need consensus. You need a coalition. And if you want to put something through AT&T, you need a coalition. And what we don't train our people is how to create that coalition. Consensus, like perfection, can sometimes kill you. When someone talks about leading and having guts, it means leading with a coalition. And that might mean not leading with everybody in your corner, and that's important. So why the coalition? The first victory is a coalition. The value of coalitions. Look, they diffuse your risk. If you have a coalition, at least you've got some people. You're sharing ideas. You're exchanging ideas. Clearly, the coalition should be as inclusive as possible. But you're sharing ideas. How are agendas moved? You know, I love these people who say, well, not politics. This is what politics is. If you believe in your ideas, go out there and create a coalition for those ideas. And be careful. I won't go into the micro skills of doing that completely, but that becomes important. Coalitions establish legitimacy of ideas. Coalitions provide political safety. Look, a friend of mine years ago, I've been around for a long time, so I get all these fancy friends. And one of them was vice president of a company called Marsh McLennan. And he once told me this great line. He said, I used to go in a room in those days, and I used to go in a room, and I looked over my shoulder, and everyone agreed until I got into the room. Right? If you're in a room, you want to make sure the people in the room understanding that you've got other people in the room with you, even if they're not there. Mm-hmm. Okay? You want to make sure they know they're there. Because people want to know that is part of what's going on. That's really hard, a notion. Coalitions deflect sabotage. Now, I know that sounds terrible, but if you've got a coalition, at least you're protected. Things don't go wrong. Now, in creating coalitions and understanding, you have to understand the political terrain of an organization. Now, for those of you that are saying, oh my God, somebody, maybe when you're undergraduate or in school, you read the book about Prince, the book The Prince, which really isn't a biography of an aging rock star. That's Purple Rain. Prince, but this is not Occasion of the Prince by Machiavellian. This is not Machiavellianism. This is not Machiavellian. To be Machiavellianism is to figure out how to use someone against their intent in terms of self-serving. You need coalitions in terms of even the common good. Even in terms of the common good. So don't give me, oh, I don't do politics. You know, if you don't do politics, you know, nothing happens. So you need to coalesce even in the common good. And if you sometimes ask me why I think we fail in organizations and in government, is because we try to make coalitions that are too big. We try to get all-inclusive about everything. And leaders are the ones that know how to make these coalitions. The first thing you need to know is how do you identify the power players? Now, some of this I do tongue-in-cheek, but some not. The top dogs. By the way, a lot of this can be the top dogs. Who are the top dogs? The person that makes the final decision. The person that makes the final decision. So let's take an executive. Who is this? Any CEOs here? You're a CEO and you're a CEO. So I need to approach, let's say, do I approach you when I'm making a decision? I want to push an idea through an organization. How do I do it? Do I come and get your blessing? I avoid you like a plague. I simply want you and the governor to know that indirectly I'm kind of thinking an idea and I want to make sure you don't get in my way too quickly. Okay? What I want to make sure is that you think it's an okay direction and you'll give me at least some room to operate if I can do something. And you won't care. And you'll do it quite positively. If I say, I have an idea, I think it's going to work, and I get someone to check, I don't want your final authority approval, yes, no, because the idea is not developed yet. I want the space to let the idea grow. And the last thing I'm going to do is come to your office and say, what do you think? It's a good idea? And you go, it's not developed, it's at this, I don't know if I should take a risk. I want to minimize the risk for you. I want to minimize the risk. One of the mistakes we do, so we want to go to the center. So now we go to the center and we decide, okay, we need support at the center. So we go, okay, Ryan, listen, we need $450,000 to the center. You want to give it? No. You don't do it like that. You think about how you move slowly. You don't go right away to the top dog right away. So that's the last thing you do. Somebody asks, who are the top dogs in the organization? In a wonderful book written years ago by a great, someone really great organization, a woman by the name of Rosabeth Cantor called Men and Women in Corporations. She talks about avoiding the top dogs. This is a book already, book in the early 80s. The top dogs, the final decision makers. You only go to them when you finally need them. The gatekeepers. You all have gatekeepers. I'm sure you had a gatekeeper, person, the people that have access to the top players. You want to know who the gatekeepers are and when to go to the gatekeepers. You then have this whole notion of the gurus. There's always in organizations that people listen to people that listen to people. And finally, you've got the players, those active people all the time in organizations. What I'm asking you, and this is just a game right now, I'm doing it tongue in cheek. But in any organization, do you know what that terrain is really like? Now, I can share some gay theoretical stuff about, but do you know what that terrain is really like? Now, once you've known the players, that's one thing, but you got to also figure out the game that they're playing. Now, I know how this sounds. You're going, the game that they're playing. No, let me tell you a game theory, okay? We all have different ways of approaching issues differently, okay? So you may approach change one way, and I may approach change another way. So you may play the change game traditionally in one way, you may be a total revolutionary, and I may be much more conservative than you, but I need to somehow figure out not only what type of power you have, but how do you approach change? What's the best thing? And if you're the CEO, I need to understand that mindset that you have. So given that, I'd like to suggest to you a couple of dimensions. Tinkerers and overhaulers. You may be a tinkerer. That's, you know, here's what tinkers would say. Here's what tinkers would say. You're moving too fast. We got to get back to basics. You don't understand our strength. All this nuts and bolts stuff. On the other hand, you get these overhaulers. You're moving too slow. This I love. You're moving the deck chairs on the Titanic. We've got to make this change right now, tomorrow morning. And then say, you're ignoring the reality of the marketplace. And then I have to figure out how you're doing the game. Are you a planner? Are you going to go step by step? I keep on pushing the wrong button. Or are you an improviser that you'll adjust accordingly? What this comes down to, and just bear with me, it comes down to this chart, and just write me, I'll send you these books, it's not a big deal. No, I'm serious. Look. There are four games that are played in organizations, and some nice experimental stuff. Adjusters, traditionalists, developers, revolutionaries, and developers. Revolutionaries. Now, I'm telling you that they play a game differently. They go through the whole notion of going all the way for the expansive notion. Now, we've got experimental psych work that shows these people tend to overreach all the time. Traditionalists, they play the game by being very grounded. Adjusters, one game at a time. Ground game, they make adjustments slowly. And developers, they go for middle-level games. Now, I won't go into this in detail right now. And I really will be happy to send you material on that you can read it. But think of the mindset, the discipline of the mindset of trying to figure out where does Ryan really belong? Now, does this mean I need to make an appointment with Stephanie to discuss Ryan or with his psychoanalyst? No. It means I need to understand for my agenda where you're likely to play the game. And I don't mean game negatively. But when you're trying to move something, there is a gamesy aspect to it. And that's what you're trying to really do. I have to figure out, in that sense, this is what doing your homework is about. It's not sitting there thinking what a brilliant damn idea you have. The last thing I tell my graduate students when they come in to defend their dissertation, and one of them is having a fit right now, stop worrying about what you wrote. Try to figure out what the five members of your committee wrote. Because they're going to be more concerned about what they wrote than what you wrote. And that's a very big deal. You know your stuff better than anybody else. But I got to figure out what Stephanie and Ryan wrote. We spend too much time worrying about our brilliant ideas. Worry about what other people's objections are. All right. Finally, this is a map. And I won't go into it now. But the whole idea of trying to figure out who the allies are, who are the potential allies, who are the resistors. How do we figure that out? Now, if we had time, we would play a six-hour game in which we should actually figure out. I mean, a few weeks ago, we took a group at Cornell, and we actually put the whole leadership team through this exercise. Figure out who are the players in the organization. You want to centralize HR in an organization. You want to centralize IT in your organization. You want to change the nature of IT in your organizations to move from the band-aid business to actually become an IT as a service in your organization. How are you going to do that? Who do you need? What are the allies? Got to figure this out. You got to figure this out. And just to give you that flavor, what I'm asking you is do your homework in terms of the actors. Then pitch your ideas and get the buy-in. In pitching your ideas, and again, this you can look up some pieces I'll send you, but pitching the ideas. I've got to pitch the ideas. And I go, okay. I also got to fix this slide. Pitch the ideas. You got to understand their fears. Not their anxiety, but their fears. They fear failure, illustrates success. They're uncomfortable with risk, minimize risk. They fear new perspective, couch it in their reality. Turf paranoia, accentuate the payoff. They fear ambiguity, be concrete. Fear losing, accentuate prestige. Meaning, don't deal from your strength. That sounds weird when I say it, but know somebody else's weakness. Mm-hmm. You've got somebody else's weakness. They've got something to lose in every move. Remember what we said about the whole notion before about the resistance here. That's the point. People are afraid to take action. Why should I? When a young faculty member, I'm a chair professor. I don't have to do anything. Why should I? I'm afraid. Well, if we're trying to change the way Cornell operates and we do that, I've got something to lose. If I want to change the way you do anything, it's kind of been good enough for you right now. So I've got to deal with those fears in a real sense. I've got to deal with those fears in a real sense. And that means I've got to get the buy-in. Now, these are hard terms. I understand. I say, get the buy-in. But you have to. Leadership is about getting the buy-in. It's about persuasion. The persuasion is about your ability to do it. And when you teach these young women, and I take it a lot of them are young, these are skills they don't think about. I'm telling you, my students don't think about. They come out, these kids come out there and tell us, oh, I had a great idea. Big deal. And everybody at Cornell thinks they're the next, Steve Jobs. You know, big deal, you got a big idea. How do you establish your credibility? And your credibility, how do you consider the expected benefits of it? How do you justify your initiative? Quickly. Sources of personal credibility. I won't go into detail, but there are ways that you go about establishing personal credibility. How do you show up what people can gain? How do you justify your initiatives? Individuals will decide whether to join you or not on the basis of you doing these three things. Finally, there's the whole notion of managerial competence. Let's say you're politically smart and you got everybody on your side and you got the agenda moving. You know what the biggest screw up in corporate world and in world of change? People drop the ball. They drop the ball. What this means, they don't keep people on their side. They don't sustain the momentum. You take the, that's why many entrepreneurial firms failed. You don't sustain the momentum. And simply put, to sustain the momentum, you've got to keep the traction moving, and I'll come closely to wrap up around this.
We're just about out of time.
We're just about one line. This is the last slide.
Okay.
You've got to create short-term wins. You got to show people it's worth it. You've got to keep on innovating and change. You've got to help fine-tune the strategies. And you got to undermine cynics and self-serving resistors, and you got to keep the bosses on board. My point is very simple. Leadership is a boring business. And if you take these young women and you convince them that what they need to do is become transformational, you don't need to become transformational, you got to be smart about your micro skills. Mm-hmm. You've got the ideas. They come in here, stop thinking that you're going to empower them. They're already empowered. Give them the skills so they can fulfill their own power. What I'm talking about them is giving them the competencies. Leadership is about that competency, these notions. They come in here empowered. And my whole notion is give them these micro skills that will allow them to drive through the organizations. I make them clear that they can understand the context, they can lead for ideation, they can be politically competent, and they need to push not to drop the ball. So that's my whole notion. The leadership, it ain't about charisma, it's not about your inner child, and it's certainly not about your great ideas. It's about your ability to execute. So thank you very, very much for your attention. I greatly appreciate it.
Thank you, Dr. Sam. I have an important announcement to make, but first, I want to say what an honor it is that we have